Well, hello and welcome to the channel. My name's Johnny and you're watching Hillbilly Modeling. So this is going to be part six of our Standard B Liberty Series 2 World War I US Army Truck by ICM. And it's in 1/35 scale. So we're going to pick up where we left off in the last video, which is painting. And, you know, it's not very glamorous, but you got to have paint, all right? So let's jump down to the bench here and get started on this. All right, so this is where we left our model in the last video. We have everything primed up in the Panzer Dark Gray. I use that instead of black. And so we've got all of our major components here painted up separately, of course, you know, or I should say primed. Now, we did in the last video paint our engine and, of course, our exhaust and intake assembly there. And, of course, we got our little tube that goes to the radiator there for our coolant. So those are already done. So I do just want to point out that I did prime up our canvas in this real light gray. As you can see, it's quite a contrast between the dark Panzer gray. And this is going to give us two different tonal bases there for our final coat of paint. So before we get to painting up the vehicle itself, we need to do a little bit of masking. Now, I'm using Tamiya masking tape. Use whatever you like, but I found the quality of this tape is so much better than just about anything else you can get out there on the market. And it doesn't necessarily pull off the paint most of the time. So we do have this frame that runs around our radiator. And the radiator is supposed to be black. And, of course, we've got our Panzer gray there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mask off these areas here to protect it from the green that we're going to apply later. And also within inside the cab, the instructions call out for a black mat on the cab floor there. So we're going to mask that off. That way we don't have to repaint it later. It's easier to get masking tape straight than it is to try to stick a brush down in there and try to paint a straight line after we've painted it green. So, you know, these Tamiya dispensers have this little teeth on the end of it there to help you tear the tape. And I make a rather mess of that. So I just use scissors. I just pull it out. Cut it off, and keeps me from wasting too much tape. So we're going to go ahead and tape up these radiator areas first. Now, getting up into the little bitty corners there is a little bit difficult, and that's because the frame actually has a little bit of an angle there. I don't know if you guys can actually see it in these pictures because that paint is so dark. But we're not going to worry about that corner. We can always touch that up after we have painted everything. So what we want to do, though, is get the major portion of our radiator all taped up. And here's those little bitty corners there that I'm talking about. So that's not going to be an issue with us. We'll come back and just touch it up with a paintbrush and kind of fix that. I don't want to be trying to paint those straight edges, so the masking tape is really going to help us there. And, of course, we have the backside of the radiator also masked off. And as you can see, there is a shroud that's going to go into place. I just want to make sure that we've got everything that was going to be visible on the vehicle covered up. And here I've went ahead and masked up the floor. Of course, as you can imagine, it gets a little tight in the corners there trying to do that. So I kind of did that off camera. So now that's ready to go. So on our actual vehicle, we're going to do a little bit of pre-shading. And I'm just going to come in and use this. This is craft paint, water-based acrylic. And yeah. Just mix it up and thin it for your airbrush, which I have right here, and make sure it's well mixed. I also screened this when I poured into my airbrush, just in case there's, you know, some little clumps or something in there that we don't want to clog up our airbrush with.
So if you are new to modeling and you don't know what pre-shading is, well, it's about adding contrast before you actually put your final or top coat of paint on, which is what color the vehicle is actually going to be. Here on top of our fenders, I'm just going to use what's called a center fill method. And then across the top of the radiator guard and our front bumper there, I'm just going to do an edge, as you can see right there. And then also right where the hood goes down, I'm just going to highlight that just a little bit. Kind of like, you know, what the sun would hit, you know, from above. And we'll do a little bit here on our radiator as well. And what this pre-shading is going to do is give us a little bit of variation in color without us having to do some post-shading. I prefer this method for doing the majority of my color deviation shading operation, because if I screw it up, which is highly likely, I can always come back in and straighten it out before I go and put the our green on. So we're going to continue with this. The point of view of viewing from above, with the sun coming down on it, and then also here on this container. Well, it's some sort of can. I think it holds the gas for the lights, but I kind of want it to be a little bit lighter than the rest of the firewall there. So we'll hit that up. And then we're going to continue on with the bed of the truck. And we're going to do this lightening of the center of the boards here. Now, these were wooden boards. And as you can see here, we're just going to go ahead and take care of those. Now, you don't have to be really, really neat in this process, because a little bit of randomness, yeah, actually a whole lot of randomness can really help with the realism of your final paint job. So you don't have to worry about it. You don't have to be spot on, which is a good thing, because my aim with this airbrush is not so good. Now moving on to our wheels. These are the dualies. The duals that go on to the rear. These are our rear wheels. I'm just going to highlight the outside of the rim there, and then right around the hub section there in the middle. And that'll give us a little bit of contrast there once we get our green on. And of course, you don't want to forget about your front wheels too. So we'll go ahead and hit those up and get those pre-shaded the same way pretty much as we did the rear. So in our color callouts there by ICM, they call for an olive green for the color of our vehicle. And I have mixed this up with a little bit of airbrush thinner from Vallejo to thin it out. And that is the craft paint that I use a lot. Now, you don't have to use the paints that I use. You know, use whatever it is that you like. I like these craft paints because they allow me to make plenty of mistakes without wasting a lot of money, and they do apply very well, and I really, really like the results that I get from it. Now here, we're going to start off with the bed here. We didn't do any pre-shading on the inside of the bed, and as you probably saw, I did paint the underside before I got started covering up the outside, or doing the outside application. Shouldn't say covering up, but I mean, it's really what we're doing. But here, we're just going over it. I'm going to get these vertical supports first, as you can see here on the outside. And we will come back in and fill in, more or less, where we have pre-shaded. But I do want to make sure that I get paint, you know, pretty much some good coverage there, because we've got a lot of different angled surfaces, and then we can come in and start doing our fill on the larger areas. Now, when it comes to painting this, you need to do it in three or four coats. This is just going to be our first coat, as you can see here. I'm just going to go over it and start to develop the color and then leave it. Because as it dries, the paint is going to change its shade. It's going to get a little bit darker. And I don't want to overpaint, because if I do that, then it might totally wipe out all the work that we did with our pre-shading, which is not advantageous to our end result or what we're actually looking to achieve here. So this is just the first coat. I kind of go over it a little bit here more than I need to at this point, but I just want to make sure that I got all the corners filled up. Then we'll just move on to the next item while, you know, the bed of the truck is drying. And I'm going to kind of concentrate here just on the inside as much as I can, trying to be a little bit precise. Although, as I mentioned before, I'm not all that precise with an airbrush. So you don't have to be a master at the airbrush to get great results. So I just need to make sure that I got paint there up underneath the seat area and up underneath the our fuel tank, which is mounted inside the cab there. So it's a good thing it's an open cab. You can imagine smelling gasoline or petrol for the rest of you guys out there. And we'll just, you know, kind of get this painted up. Now, I did paint the bottom of it first before I started doing the exterior of the cab. That way, I don't have any areas where my clips are going to keep it from, you know, getting paint on. Now, I will say that you need to be as consistent as possible on the amount of paint that you apply on your first coat, and then the same thing with your second and third coat. That way, your color intensity comes out correctly. I don't know if I'm conveying that the way I think I am, but this green is going to dry darker than what it looks like when we spray it on. And of course, since we have a dark base underneath it there with that dark primer, you just kind of want to make sure that all of our highlights and stuff kind of match between all the different units that we're painting up, because we're painting the bed and the cab, as you can see here, the frame separately. So we do want to keep making comparisons between these different items. That way, hopefully everything is going to be in harmony with all the other parts. I hope that makes sense. And with any painting session, just make sure that you have everything situated and grouped together so that you don't leave things out, like the wheels here in this case, because preparation and organization is going to make your painting sessions go along a lot smoother. And I mean, who likes to have to go back and clean that airbrush for a third or fourth time because we forgot to paint something, you know? So yeah, just make sure that you get everything together before you start spraying, and that'll save you a lot of heartache there later on. Okay, with our primary painting done, we can go ahead and remove all of this masking tape that we've got on here. So we do want to be careful trying to get this masking tape off. We don't want to be scratching our Panzer Dark Gray or our black underneath. That way it'll be less forced to touch up later on. And as you can see, the masking tape helps us keep nice straight lines there. And we can go ahead and remove this masking also on the floor of our cab that covers up those black mats that are there on the floor. We do need to be really careful here that we don't break our steering column loose. So we have to be gentle when pulling off this masking tape. And as you can see there, we've got those nice black mats there, per the instructions. And yeah, with a little bit of weathering, that's going to look nice. Now we do need to do some touch-up. And like I mentioned before, it would have been really difficult to get into those angled corners of the radiator frame So we're just going to come in with the same mixture that we used before to prime everything, and just touch that up. And this being a water-based acrylic, it's going to dry really smooth, and it's going to be just like all the other paint there on our radiator. So next, just to keep all of our parts count down as we start our assembly, we need to go ahead and assemble our fan shroud. Now it has two large pins there at the top that helps us locate the correct orientation of our fan shroud. If we get it upside down, then the fan on the engine is not going to fit into place, which is already cemented on the engine, and that could be a problem during our final assembly. And I'm just going to use Tamiya Extra Thin here, and that is a solvent. So I am doing it now because all these parts are going to get a flat clear coat eventually, and I don't want any glue marks or cement marks on that. So we'll go ahead and cement this into place. Just like so. Now, when it comes to our tires, here we do have some overspray, which we need to clean up. And I'm just going to go back to the same base color that we used before to prime everything, and that's that Panzer Dark Gray that I used. Now, you could use black if that's what you want to do. You don't have to do the same color coordination or combination that I do, but since I am using the airbrush mixture, it really flows around that nice sharp rim that we have here on the molded wheels. And then we don't want to forget the back side because we do have some overspray there too, so we'll go ahead and clean that up. That way we've got a nice sharp line there that really differentiates the difference between our rim and our rubber tires there. So now to our canvas. Now, as you can see, I primed all this in that light gray. That's Vallejo light gray. And I did paint the inside of it when I was painting the rest of the vehicle because that's all going to be in shadows. So I sprayed all that olive green there, and that is what we're going to use again on our canvas. Now the instructions does call out for a khaki, so but I have seen photographs of what appears to be green canvas as well, so I think I want to choose a green canvas kind of motif. Is that the right word? It might be, I don't know. So when it comes to painting our canvas, we obviously don't want this as dark as the rest of the vehicle. So the light gray is going to really help us there. And then we'll just go ahead and shoot on three coats, I guess, of this olive over top of that light gray. And since we have that light gray underneath our olive, it's going to come out lighter for us. Well, I mean, in all reality, if you actually saturate any part with enough paint, it's all going to come out the same color. So you don't want to do that. So applying light passes is going to get us there without overdoing it. And we don't want our canvas to be the same shade as the rest of the vehicle. So that's why I used two different primer coats there. Now here we're getting ready to run our second pass, and since the paint is a little bit thin, you can see that it is kind of sinking in and creating a little bit of modulation for us, and that's nice to see. I don't know where we're going to end up yet, but we're just going to keep putting our paint on until I kind of get it to where my eye thinks it should be. And as you can see, I am spraying it with the airbrush well away from the part, probably somewhere around, 5 to 7 inches. That way I get the widest dispersion of the paint without setting up a pattern. So it's just something that I do trying to get an even coat on. And we don't want to forget our canvas top for our cab as well. And then you can see here, we're going back in with our third pass. And as you paint, and this paint being a water-based acrylic, it really does dry fast, but you can always hit it with a hair dryer, something of which I lack somewhat of is hair, but I do have a hair dryer, which speeds up the evaporation of our water that's in our paint there, and that allows us to go ahead and put another coat on without having to stop and clean our airbrush and all that, because you don't want to leave paint sitting in your airbrush. That never turns out well. So now I just want to show you the reason why I kind of mixed this olive green thinner than what I normally would. And as you can see, it really has started to go ahead and develop all of those little different hues and deviations there in the canvas force. And that looks pretty good, to be honest with you. And in most situations, you might not want to even touch it. But of course, I'm going to go ahead and touch it. Can't leave well enough alone. So, yeah, we've got all of these striations. I guess that's what you call them. Little folds. That's really what I'm getting at here in the little wrinkles and stuff in the canvas. And maybe we can bring that out just a little bit more, you know, kind of give it some highlights there. And so I'm going to use some of this tester's enamel, and this is the flat tan, and you could use deck tan or whatever, but I like using these solvent-based tester's paints, which are enamels, for dry brushing, and that's what we're going to do here. So I did moisten the bristles on the brush there with a little bit of enamel thinner. Now, since we are blending this on over top of an acrylic paint, we don't have to worry about it dissolving our acrylics. And with any dry brushing, you need to remove most of the paint. So we load the bristles with our flat tan there, and then we wipe most of that off. And the whole point here is to go through and catch the edges. Now, I do have a little bit too much paint there on the brush. So the good thing about using these enamels is that you can always come back in and blend using a fairly clean, dry brush with just a little bit of enamel thinner on it there to kind of take care of anything where you get too much on there. But as you can see here with the dry brushing, we're starting to pull out that ribbing there from the bows that hold our canvas up. And then we're going to use that also to kind of define all the high sections here in the canvas. And we're just going to keep going around and doing this until we get as uniform of a look as possible. And you don't want to forget your end curtains, you know. Kind of think of you got to look at it as a whole, not just little bitty sections. And of course, we're going to have to go back and reload our brush often with paint as we use up what little bit of paint that is actually on the brush. We'll have to keep doing that. And here we go. So we have hit some highlights there, and that really helps bring out those little folds and stuff. And we, of course, we did our canvas that goes over the cab as well there. It doesn't look too shabby. So now when it comes to the bows that are extending down onto the side of the bed of the truck, I kind of want that a little bit darker of an olive green. So I need to go back in and establish that dark primer. So we're just going to hit that up, and I'm kind of skipping over the clamp. That way the clamp will have a different shade of green. than the wooden part, which is these canvas bows. So we're going to paint these in just using that same primer mixture that we used before in our first painting stage when we primed everything with that dark Panzer gray. Now with that done, I can come back in with our green, and that's the olive green. And these are craft paints. Of course, you don't have to use craft paints, but I do like using the water-based acrylics because you can thin them to whatever consistency that you want without too much trouble there. And we'll just paint up the wooden parts there, the little bows. So next up, we do need a post-shading color, and we're going to use our olive green and some white here. And this is the same paint that we used to paint the entire vehicle. And as you can see, I'm kind of trying to keep it down to as few colors or few paints that I need. That way, everything is kind of in the same paint family. Does that make sense? You know, I'm not using a tremendous amount of different shades and stuff. I'm just using the same base colors and either making them lighter or darker. And that way, we can see exactly how many different contrasting colors we can get out of that. And since everything is in the same family of green, this olive green that we've got going on, it should make the vehicle look more realistic. Or at least that's my intent. We'll see how that works. So I did lighten up the olive green with that white. And I added a little bit of that airbrush thinner there to kind of thin it out for us. Because these craft paints can be a little gel-like. You know, they are quite thick. But you got to be careful. If you put too much thinner in there, it will turn very watery kind of quick on you. So just add a little bit at a time and mix it up until you get the consistency that you want. And then we can go ahead and use that. So this is kind of like post-shading, except we're not doing large areas. We're just doing small items here to help bring the contrast out. Now, when this really light green that we've mixed up dries, it's going to turn darker. So that's fine. That's okay. And if you want it a little bit more pronounced, you can go over it with a second or third coat to get the contrast that you want. Here, we're just doing the, I think these are like rivet heads where the bed of the truck or bolt heads, I think they're carriage bolts, to be honest with you. And we're just using a toothpick instead of a paintbrush because these are really, really small details. And yes, you can paint with a toothbrush or a cocktail stick, whatever your preference is in calling these. That helps us really get very accurate with it. And we can just touch it to the tops of all of these little, I think they're carriage bolts. And as you can see there, we also did the hooks, the top of the hooks there for the rope that holds our canvas down. And yeah, that looks pretty good. So we're going to need to do this on the rest of the vehicle. So on the cab section here, right on the firewall there, we're going to use that same toothpick to paint up these little loops here that are molded in. And then also we have some bolt detail that we need to do. So we can go ahead and paint all that up. And then, of course, you know, can't forget about the frame and the front fenders and all that because they all have bolts and stuff that need to be highlighted. So that's the whole idea there. That way that makes those little details stand out for us.
Okay, so that's all we have time for here in this video. I don't want to get too long. So I did go ahead and dry fit our cab into place and our radiator with, of course, the engine because we put that fan shroud on. I want to make sure that that doesn't bind up with putting the engine in, and that's okay. We're in good shape there. And the other thing that I wanted to look at and check is to see whether or not our pre-shading was going to conflict. You know, does it all go together harmoniously? So yeah, and I think we're looking pretty good there. So we're in good shape. So we got all that done. And like I said, I just dry fitted that together. I did the same thing here with the bed of the truck, to check out our canvas. Now our canvas is green and not the, khaki, that it's calling for, but I don't think it looks too bad. I think it looks pretty good. I'm not really great at canvas, so I'm still kind of working on that. So, but it looks pretty good. And of course, we did the canvas for the cab too. So, all right, that's it for this video, and we'll get into some sponge chipping and weathering. Oh, we still got some detail painting to do. Taking care of the lights and the little refractors and stuff like that, and also our seats. We haven't even touched those yet, so we're gonna try to make those look like used seats. So that's coming up in the next video, and I hope you guys stay tuned and watch that. So special thanks to all my subscribers. It's because of you guys I keep making these videos, and I hope that you enjoyed this one. And if you did, I appreciate it if you'd give us a like. And if you're new to the channel, I hope today I earned your subscription. So with that, you guys stay safe, and I'll see you in the next one.